slight change of program because Professor Vuanic is kind of feeling unwell, so we would move the reading laboratory as was planned for 2 p.m. and we will resume with today's sessions. So today we have Mr. Juan Almada Arvantes, kind of. Who will give a lecture between being and becoming towards a metaphysical reading of architectural science with Professor Reiter's comments, and afterwards we will probably finish around 5:30, so as well maybe we can have more time for comments and maybe a bit more time for discussions depending on the issues, of course, in the lectures. So we can begin now.
Thanks for the presentation, and I would state from the beginning that the intention of this lecture is to provide a sort of big picture that allows us to connect many of the subjects that have been already posed in this interesting setting. So my intention is to provide this sort of zooming out in order to connect items. Well, the aim of this lecture is to provide some insights about the relationship between architecture and metaphysics. I am pretty aware that since at least 300 years of development of Western philosophical traditions, that means since Kant, and especially after Nietzsche, metaphysics has become a subject under the spotlight and has got a sort of bad reputation. In some contemporary circles related to the field of cultural studies and gender studies, it is even a synonym of a sort of patriarchal, Western, Anglo-phallocentric paradigm. And as such, it shares roles with the devil himself. But this evil character has played a major role within the field of architecture since the Greeks, both as a model for theory and practice. So, after a brief introduction about the general meaning of metaphysics as such, my presentation will show three ways of understanding its specific ties with architecture. First of them will be metaphysics as an agent of the design process. Second, the Derrida way, and find a better way of calling it, which will be confronted with a more phenomenological approach. And third, metaphysics as a formal language. All this followed by a conclusion. We all have a certain intuitive idea about what metaphysics means. Within the Western philosophical tradition, it has constituted the essential form of the old question about meaning. Taking as reference the analogy proposed by Heidegger in his text What is Metaphysics from 1929, if philosophy is a tree that unfolds its branches in multiple directions, metaphysics corresponds to its roots, like the foundations of a building. The roots go deep in search for the answer to a fundamental question, what is being? But as they go deeper and deeper, they start to get entangled into themselves, because the question that guided them contains a tautological reference. Being is always explained by being in an ontotheological process, focused on its different modes of manifestation, whether in the form of substance, spirit, God, etc. Following the critical analysis proposed by Heidegger, this historical process has paradoxically transformed metaphysics into a veil that, from Plato, has avoided an effective questioning about the real essence of being as such. This metaphysical thinking, in its specific Platonic form, has been in turn the prevailing paradigm for the arts, understood as forms of manifestation of ideas or concepts that can acquire corporeal presence through a specific material substratum, but always transcending it. The hierarchical subordination of the material principle to the idea, which appears as the true provider of its potential meaning, as an angel that brings a redeeming light from above and beyond, is one of the clearest manifestations of the prevalence of metaphysical thought in the field of Western artistic production. Now, in the case of architecture, the long shadow of this angel that brings light from above and beyond has been particularly strong. Since the Greeks, ideals of mathematical perfection, formal coherence, unity between part and whole, harmony, etc., have constituted a priori concepts of any design process. In the form of canons of proportions, for example, they effectively transcend their specific material incarnations, constituting a set of a priori constrictions. The internal laws of these sets of constrictions may change from style to style, from one epoch to the other, but they seem to be there always as models that predefine and precede the execution of the architectural form. That is to say, they are not dependent on experience and materialization. In this sense, they constitute an unavoidable metaphysical substratum that cannot be detached, an invisible layer that cannot be deleted, a layer that today, due to the incorporation of digital technologies that blend modeling and execution stages, tends to become closer and materialize itself in the form of real-time algorithms and dynamic responsive parametric models. Through technology, the gap between idealization and material conformation narrows. As a consequence of the will of immediateness and instantaneity that characterizes the spirit of our epoch, our zeitgeist. Thus, this losing of distance and blurring of the limits between idea and material form imply the destruction of the metaphysical substratum in its traditional sense. If the angel becomes too close, he loses his angelical status. In any case, this is a first way of understanding the role of metaphysics within architecture as an irreducible agent of the design process. A second way is the Derrida way, expressed in his mythical statement, "Architecture is the last stronghold of metaphysics." A statement that is inscribed within a comprehension of metaphysics that in a strict sense does not reach the level of a true ontological reflection, but is rather retained in the sphere of cultural critique. For him, the metaphysical dimension of architecture is represented in four historical axioms: dwelling as a function, that means architecture as an object for a subject; the symbolic dimension, architecture as a symbol of cultural categories like our religion, etc.; architecture as a subordinate medium to this symbolic function; and the will of beauty and formal coherence inherited from the Greeks. According to Derrida, these four dimensions, or fictions, configure a sort of veil that has historically concealed and avoided the possibility of liberating architecture as a practice open to a plurality of polyvalent meanings, not necessarily convergent. Leaving aside the question if Derrida and his deconstructivist colleagues effectively succeeded in this liberation crusade, this whole discourse is implicitly inscribed in a critique of normative power structures, the discourse of power, so characteristic of post-structuralist philosophy, oriented to cultural criticism. Within this theoretical frame, metaphysics and architecture are disposed in a sort of critical relationship. The question is, what happens after the liberation? Is this word here still architecture, or is it nothing? An open question. Now, if we try to read the link between architecture and metaphysics from a phenomenological perspective, the terms of the equation and the relationships are others. Phenomenology, as a method of knowledge linked to the experience of things themselves, following the original definition of Husserl, is a way that allows us to establish a bridge between sensitive phenomena and its formalization as abstract theoretical fiction, and as such, as a natural affinity with the field of architecture as an epistemic tool. From this perspective, which constitutes the theoretical frame of this brief essay, concepts that are traditionally related to the field of metaphysics, such as space, time, and even, finding architecture a privileged medium of manifestation as concrete existential dimensions that configure our experience of being in the world. architecture gives a body to this poor wandering souls. Through architecture, being becomes existence, time becomes becoming, and space becomes place or logos. Architecture is the missing link between meta and physics, a central idea for physics that I will reinforce today. Before that, I will briefly focus my analysis on time and the ways in which this ultra-metaphysical concept materializes through architecture. What does this mean? Isn't it time, in conjunction with the three dimensions of space, just a sort of intangible fourth dimension that situates us in the continuous flow from past to future? How can it be specifically materialized through architecture? And this relates directly to the topic that we were addressing yesterday. The primary manifestations of time as phenomena are, of course, found in nature itself, mainly in the form of movement and change. The cosmic rhythms of the seasons, the movements of the stars, the morphological changes that these cyclic processes generate in multiple scales of observation are all forms in which time incarnates itself as an incessant blind metabolic process that is also reflected in our own physiological constitution. This is time in its natural form, but when it is mediated through architecture, it acquires direction and measurement as an existential dimension. Through architecture, time unfolds basically in five ways. First dimension would be called performer. This is the act of dwelling itself, which implies the dynamics of movement, change, use, interaction, etc. Architecture as a platform of events which unfold in time. Second dimension could be the chronological. This is the reading of time as aging and decay, entropy of materials and their renovation. The direct reading of time. The third dimension could be called typological. This is the reference to time as reference to history, the use of typologies in Rossi, for example, in the postmodern movement, all the neos, and so this is more a semiotic interpretation of time. Science. The fourth dimension could be the mimetic, which means basically the mimesis of time as frozen dynamics of movement, from Baroque to our contemporary parametric biomorphological experiments. This is highly formalist and is related to this notion of frozen music. And the fifth dimension, which is the one which I will address specifically, could be something that sounds a bit paradoxical, but is timelessness, a sort of counter. This dimension is one of the most recognizable ways in which metaphysics has been interpreted as a formal language within architecture, since he addresses this timelessness in his beautiful paintings. This referential image, taken from Stanley Kubrick's masterpiece 2001, condenses the meaning of this idea of timelessness in a sign. Just like an angel, the monolith comes to the earth from above and beyond. It doesn't belong to nature, to the physics. It seems to be detached from its laws. That is to say, it is not subjected to the cyclic laws of birth, life, decay, and death. It is eternal and perfect in its geometric integrity. It is not made of natural materials, but rather from an abstract, black, inorganic matter. In this sense, it establishes a radical counterpoint with its context, a contrast that paradoxically allows reaffirming both in their own essence. Through the presence of the monolith, physics is more physics, stone is more stone, clouds are more clouds, and humans become aware of their own condition as rational and sentient beings. The monolith stages life, putting in value the contraposition between the eternal and the ephemeral, between fixedness and movement, between abstraction and nature, and perhaps also between mind and body. With Kant, we could also say that the monolith is the sublime incarnation a posteriori of an intuition, a possibility that was already present a priori into the minds of these pathetic humans ate. Now, there are architectures that in a way can be understood as fragments of this monolith, dispersed on Earth since the beginning of time. They share the same attributes, geometric perfection, associated to the use of platonic forms as formal archetypes. Most of them tend to symmetry, which is a form of integrity and stability. They are icons in synthetic terms. They are expressions of the human will for eternity, and for the same reason, they tend to have religious or iconic functions as symbols of power or utopias. This gives them a certain sense of detachment from their specific contexts, reinforced by their inherent timelessness. This implies that they establish an irreducible distance, which tends to privilege a more optic way of experience. All these attributes give them the quality of being sublime in a Kantian sense, a quality that in some cases can be underlined by specific attributes of mathematical perfection and formal coherence. We can affirm that any metaphysical architecture is sublime because of this miraculous condition of incarnation of a priori objects of intuition. But I would dare to say that the sublime in architecture does not always imply a metaphysical character. The products of the contemporary digital sublime, for example, are more oriented to the aesthetics of miracle, as general concept, and they are more in the field of time mimicking, one of the points which I prefer. Now, what is the role of matter, of materiality, in this metaphysics of timelessness? Doesn't it appear in a way as a complete subordinated principle? Is it possible to integrate it in a more equilibrated way without destroying the metaphysical expression? This is the question that has guided the praxis of contemporary architects like Peter Sumner, for example. His theoretical frame is highly oriented to phenomenology with a strong Heideggerian background, and this allows him to put in value metaphysics not in terms of a detached and abstract reflection, but rather as an existential value embedded in life and sensitive experience. This is just a pure coincidence. I had the same example. Well, it's okay because we can see the same thing from different. His brother Klaus Chapel in Metternich, Germany, is an interesting example of this will. We can say that the monolith of Kubrick becomes a dwelling place as an inhabitable body with outside and inside. Its external appearance speaks the language of the Apollonian timelessness, an abstract prismatic volume with no representational or mimetic character, a form of pure presence. But seen from a closer perspective, subtle details give it a more embodied character. The concrete surface is traced by the marks of the formworks. It has a skin that opens through a single triangular door, revealing an internal Dionysian world that apparently contradicts the Apollonian expression of the outside. It appears as a sort of irregular cave which leads to the place of the altar. This place, in turn, opens itself to the sky through a circular opening in the top, creating a strong vertical tension reinforced by the textures of the walls, which, as you already know, were created by burning the logs that were originally used as formworks. The conjunction of spatial, luminic, and tactile properties create a sort of amplified visual and sensitive experience, that is to say, a true atmosphere. But despite this sensitive accentuation, the space does not lose its sacred character. That is to say, it remains faithful to its primary function, which is basically to generate an introspective state which allows the act of worship and prayer. Matter becomes an actor of the play in a living world, but the script keeps on being metaphysical in its most pure essence. The vertical tension of the space sublimes matter as a vehicle for the incarnation of the spirit, which comes in the form of light, from above and beyond. Both matter and spirit form an indissoluble alliance in equilibrium. Now, to end, doing a deep analogy in ontological terms. From a deeper perspective, this project of Sunto is a metaphor, a translation of our own condition as human beings from a holistic perspective. We are in the articulation point between all the dimensions that constitute our experience of being in the world. Below, the material and concrete dimensions of existence, the force that tends to multiplication and flow, the complexity of the interactions within space and time, with the body as the main determinant factor operating in the senses of proximity. Over the immaterial dimensions, which relate to a more contemplative, abstract, and optical relationship with reality, pure consciousness, will of order, and rational comprehension. So, we understand the human being as a territory of permanent friction between these two wheels, between these two forces, perfectly described by Nietzsche as the Apollonian and Dionysian dimensions of reality. The cosmological principles of unity and dissolution, of order and chaos, incarnate themselves in our own dynamic experience as conscious beings in the world. And when we talk of a certain will of perfection, an intention to live our life in the plenitude of its own hybrid condition between these two beings, maybe we are talking essentially of attaining a state of equilibrium between these forces, just like the Chapel of Sunto. Not the pure spiritual disembodiment, and not just the pure functional immersion in the vortex of emotion and chaos and matter, but rather to be like the sun, a shining center in which all these dimensions converge and appear to be unified in equilibrium. Through architecture, maybe we can finally understand that we are the missing link between matter and physics, between me and economy.
So, well, thank you very much for this lecture and showed us door into metaphysics, architecture and metaphysics. Okay, choose it. You?
Thanks, but what if becoming is the real meaning of being?
I think that's my thesis. Till now, we have thought of these two wheels as separated. Platonic perfection is the point at which they touch in beautiful. The notion of beauty is the point in which these two things join. But from a more vitalistic and organic perspective, those are the same. This sphere here, joined with one single expression. So I would say that there's no radical distinction between these two things. If we think of them in a more, I would say, presocratic way, but like Heraclitus, for instance, thinks of the whole as a whole. There's no meta, it's a game. In that sense, we could make a sort of connection between architecture and metaphysics. Arche refers to origin, meta projects this origin outside, but we're doing it back. So I would say that they are sort of two sides of the same coin, so to say.
I think you haven't answered the question. Can you repeat your question? I think he has not answered the question.
He?
Yeah.
No. No, I wonder if you believe in a transcendent world, in a eternal truth, in a truth that is stable, universal, in opposition to the becoming, to the finitude of the existence.
No. You're asking me.
Yeah, because I wonder.
I would say that
if your view is Neoplatonic view, excuse me, it's Neoplatonic, please.
It's a matter of perspective. I would go fully into the Nietzschean mode, in the conception of the eternal return, in which he, of course, brings back this notion of metta into the immanent realm of experience in a sort of phenomenic approach on things themselves. So I'm full on that. I just, maybe I should have done the circle here, which I have. Not here, but here. Both realms are one. It's a blending of both. I could not think of a sort of a distancing, but rather a holistic conjunction both from a more organic physiological.
Okay, yes, four questions. You, Sneshana, Atria, and Kala, you two, and Kaspar. Maybe we start with Kaspar.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then we go out and then.
It's not so complex, I think, my question. It's just, I was wondering, now it's the second time we see Peter Tumtor featured. And he's become quite canonical in phenomenology. You have the same architects usually reappearing, Alvarez, so. Khan, Alvaro Siza, perhaps, and then Zumthor. So, and that could lead some to think that is that all? Do we only have those examples today of metaphysical architecture? Is that what about the architecture at large? What about the whole range of expressions that we see? And if you think about Kenneth Frampton's critical regionalism, he was very clearly stating that that his proposal would be an architect, a minority architect, that could not be applied to the world at large. It would be outside of globalization in a way. So he was very clear about that his heroes, Utzon, Aalto, Caesar, Barragán, and so on, would be form a culture outside the mainstream culture. So he was very clear that he didn't end up saying that these should be canonical in that sense, that they would be a kind of habitat for a certain culture. So how do you position those two traditions of Frampton's very clear distinction between majority and minority and more? And then you have the phenomenological narratives that are more, I think, unclear about the question of whether this notion of metaphysics can be extended to the culture at large, to the life world. So, I'm just,
I would say that, of course, the notions that I am presenting here are applicable in a larger scale. The use of Zumthor as an example is basically an instrumental strategy to refer to a sort of contemporary language. But my intention was, of course, to propose this reading, metaphysical reading of architectural science in a much more expanded way, which could be applied as sort of analytical frame to the Pantheon in Rome, for example. I could have replaced this with the Pantheon, I would say it would work. It's because of its meta condition. Mm. The meta discourse is applicable in a sort of meta contextual approach. Mm. It's because of this zoom out that I stated at the beginning. So in that sense, it's a sort of polyvalent frame of interpretation can be applied in different contexts. Not a specific. I'm not afraid, I mean, yeah, something's important, but I would not like to get stuck there. Mm.
Okay, Nikos.
Yes. I would like to add something to the question, the first question about being and becoming, and especially because you used Zumthor's chapel. I don't know if you know the method how he created the interior of that chapel. He used the logs to put inside and created a fire, which then created a void inside of the the chapel, inside of the building, and then the result was the space inside, and it has a certain structure that is the result of the logs we choose.